mentors and empowering them to grow spiritually in God's word and reaching out to share the good news of Jesus. Join me now in our call to worship, sing songs of hope and peace. God's love and power have lifted us up. Sing songs of mercy and grace. God's mercy and forgiveness frame our lives. Thanks be to God for all God's love and mercy. Praise be to God for the healing power that God extends to each of us. Amen. Our opening hymn is All Hail the Power, number 154 of the United Methodist Hymn.
Jordan turned back. The mountains skipped like rams.
is it, O sea, that you flee? O Jordan, that you turn back? O mountains, that you skip like rams? O hills, like lambs? Tremble, O earth, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of the God of Jacob, who turns the rock into a pool of water, the flint into a spring of water. Our next scripture lesson comes from Romans 14 chapter, verses 1 through 12. Welcome the person who is weak in faith, but not in order to argue about differences of opinion. One person believes in eating everything, while the weak person eats only vegetables. Those who eat must not look down on the ones who don't. The ones who don't eat must not judge the ones who do, because God has accepted them. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? They stand or fall before their own Lord, and they will stand because the Lord has the power to make them stand. One person considers some days to be more sacred than others, while another person considers all days to be the same. Each person must have their own conviction. Someone who thinks that a day is sacred thinks that way for the Lord, the one who eats for the Lord, because they thank God, and those who don't eat for the Lord, and they thank the Lord too. We don't live for ourselves, and we don't die for ourselves. If we live, we live for the Lord, and if we die, we die for the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or die, we belong to God. This is why Christ died and lived, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. But why do you judge your brother or your sister? Or why do you look down on your brother or sister? We all stand in front of the judgment seat of God, because it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow to me, and every tongue will give praise to God. So then, each of us will give an account of ourselves to God. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Join me now in our historic confession of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
part that I announced the passing of Ms. Annalee Johnson, who passed this morning. Her funeral services will be held this Saturday at the church. Keep an eye out or ear open for more details about the services. As always, we lift up our sick and shut-in, Angela Brown, Willie Brown, Ed Collins, Viola Collins, Maddie Dorsey Crane, David Marino, Garland Hart, who had surgery last week and has recovered and is doing fine, Desmond Hart, Senator Hartley, Pauline Jagery, Eugene Lee, Olander Lester, Joe Long, Mary Porter, Mary Rollins, Easter Smith, Crystal Williams. We also want to keep in our prayers Alan Dale, who is in the hospital, as they try to figure out what is going on with him. And we also want to keep the Archie family in prayer as we have an ongoing celebration for Miss Esther on yesterday. Let us go to God in prayer. Most holy and gracious God, we give you thanks and praise for this day. We thank you for loving us so much and for always providing whatever we need. We come asking that you forgive us when we have fallen short of your glory. We pray for those, our members who are bereaved, the Archie family, the Johnson family. Bless them, Lord, and comfort them. Give them the peace of God that passes all understanding. We thank you for Darlene's successful surgery. Continue to bless and keep her. Be with Alan Bell as his doctors try to figure out the source of his medical concerns. Continue to grow his faith and his dependence on you. We pray for all the people out of California, Oregon, who are suffering from the ravaging fires that have overtaken their states. And we pray for those in Lake Charles as they take steps to rebuild their lives after Hurricane Laura. Lord God, send them all the help that they need. With all that is going on, we this morning are standing in the bullseye of Hurricane Sally. And Lord, we pray that you keep us safe from the ravages of the storm and that you help us to take precautions we need to be safe. Lord, if we need to move, tell us to evacuate and move. Let no one be sovereign and stay when they can go somewhere and be safe. We pray for your comfort for all those in our country who have lost loved ones or a job during this pandemic. Lord, we just ask that you bless and keep them. We pray for our children away at college and those who are beginning a new school year, Lord. Keep them and the teachers as well safe from COVID. Lord God, get a hold of our leaders. Endow them with wisdom so they know what to do to navigate us through these difficult times. We, with all that is going on, Lord God, we still are standing will now have our ministry of music faithful.
Faithful, 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 fa
starting at the 21st verse, going through to the end. Listen for the word of the Lord. Then Peter came and said to him, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Jesus said to him, not seven times. I tell you 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him, and as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold together with his wife and children and all the possessions and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of the slave released him and forgave him the debt. But the same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. And when he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their Lord all that had taken place. Then the Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all the debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his Lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Most gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for this day. We thank you for another opportunity to worship and praise your holy name. We pray that as your word goes forth, that it will accomplish what you set it out to do, and not return to your void. Open our hearts and our minds to hear the word that you have for us today. And now, Lord God, remove me from me. Hide me beneath the cross, beneath the drippings of your precious blood. And when I speak, let it be your voice that is heard. And when I sing, let it be you that is seen. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Let the church say, amen. The gifts we receive from God are not for us alone. God blesses us so we can be a blessing to others. God loves us so that we can love others. God comforts us so that we can comfort others. God encourages us so we can encourage others. It's the same with God's gift of forgiveness. As forgiven people, we must be forgiving. For Christians, it's just as important to be forgiving as it is to be loving. I believe that forgiving is an act of love. Forgiving is so important that it's something we pray about. It's no accident that forgiveness is a part of the Lord's Prayer. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Forgiving is so important that it's written about in the Bible at least 75 times. As essential as forgiving is to the life of a Christian, sometimes it's hard for us to forgive. It's hard because most of the time when we are harmed, we get all wrapped up in our feelings. Being wrapped up in our feelings can lead to a desire to strike back. Anger and resentment is not a good place to be. In a state of anger and resentment, we might say something or do something that we will later regret. There are times when folk will do something to us and we find ourselves asking for forgiveness before we act. You know what I'm talking about. Lord, forgive me because I'm about to give Sister So-and-so a piece of my mind. Has anybody been there, or am I the only one? When we have asked for forgiveness before we act, it's a sure sign that we should not do what we are thinking about doing. Most of us have been harmed by another person at one time or another, so we can relate to Peter's question in our text. Lord, if a brother sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Perhaps Peter thought of seven because it's a symbolic meaning of completion or perfection. Or maybe he felt he could handle seven times, but no more. Imagine if Jesus would have said, "You're exactly right, Peter. You have spoken well. Seven times of forgiving a brother or sister is enough." If Jesus had said that, we would be having forgiveness countdowns. Every time someone would do something, our response would be, "I forgive you this time, but you only have six more times left." Instead, Jesus sets the bar much higher. Jesus said 77 times. Jesus' response is not about man. It's not about us keeping track of how many times someone harms us. If we have to keep track of every time we forgive a person, we have to ask ourselves, have we truly forgiven and are we acting in love? Remember, Paul says in Corinthians that love is patient and kind and does not insist on its own way. As believers, we're living under the infinite grace of God. Daily, we ask for forgiveness, not just for the things we do, but even for the things we think about. Where would we be if God didn't forgive us? We are forgiven, and so we must forgive. As participants in God's kingdom, forgiving is what we do. Jesus further tells Peter a parable about the need to be forgiving. In his parable, Jesus talks about a servant who could not repay a debt to his master. The servant begged his master for forgiveness, and out of pity, the master forgave his servant. One would think because of the forgiveness that this servant experienced, he would be willing to forgive others. Yet this servant would not forgive a fellow servant who owed him. The unforgiving servant threw his fellow servant into prison. when word got back to the unforgiving servant's master, his master was outraged and told the unforgiving servant he should have shown the same mercy to his fellow servant that he was shown. The master punished the servant until he paid what he owed. Jesus ends this parable by saying that this is what will happen to everyone who does not forgive their brother or sister. Jesus said we must forgive from the heart. This is so important because we have been forgiven, and there is no room for unforgiveness in the church. Jesus teaches us to forgive because of the spiritual and physical consequences of unforgiveness. Those consequences are too much for us to bear. Forgiveness is good not only for our good, not only for the good of the person we forgive. Like the unforgiving servant, we risk losing the gift of being forgiven if we do not forgive. Not only that, we will develop mental and physical issues from carrying around unforgiveness in our hearts. Sometimes, years and years can go by, and if you never forgave the person who hurt you, you'll carry all that pain and hurt deep inside. You will not be consciously aware of this hurt, but it could cause you to have unexplained pain or ailment. I've experienced this myself. One of my friends from college harmed me badly when we were in college. And some 30 years later, I was in touch with this person trying to get in contact with someone else. Out of the blue, my college friend said, "I'm sorry for what I did to you. Can you forgive me?" And I said yes. And as I said yes, I feel a muscle in my back loosen. I had been carrying that emotional pain so long, I had just gotten used to it and didn't even know it was there. Sometimes when we find ourselves being unable to forgive, it's because we are focusing on the wrong things. We remember every little detail of how we were mistreated. I'm not saying that we have to forgive and forget. Forgiveness does not require us to be in a state of denial about the harm that we have suffered. Forgiveness does not require us to pretend that the offense did not hurt. Sometimes we need to remember what happened so we never put ourselves in that position again. We need to name the pain and the hurt and give it to God. That is what Jesus did on the cross. He did not forgive those who were crucified. He prayed for God to forgive them. Sometimes we think that forgiving is an open invitation to let people walk all over us. When we loan someone money and they fail to pay us back, we can forgive them for not paying us back, but that doesn't mean we have to keep on loaning them money. Jesus calls us to have discerning spirits. He doesn't call us to be fools. Jesus calls us to be wise as servants, but gentle as doves. As the old saying goes, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Forgiveness is not an open invitation for others to keep on using us, nor is forgiveness something that keeps us from standing up for what is right and speaking out against what is wrong. We can forgive and still speak out against injustice and wrongdoing. Here is something else to remember. There is no forgiveness without repentance. Those who forgive must change their ways or they're not truly forgiven. One of the things we can do to get unstuck in unforgiveness is to refocus our thinking. Paul reminds us in Philippians, whatever is true, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. When we think on the things that Paul suggests, we won't dwell on our hurt. When thinking about good things and thinking about things worthy of praise, it's also good to remember who we are and whose we are. We are a child of the Most High God. Our God knows all and sees all. God sees when somebody wrongs us. We can be assured that God will not be mocked. When someone does something against a child of God, they are planting a seed that will come back up in their lives. We don't have to let ourselves get pulled down to the level of those who harmed us. God will fight our battles. We can forgive and let go and let God. We can stand back and watch God fight our battles. When thinking of good things and things worthy of praise, we can think about the goodness of Jesus. We can think about how he laid down his life so that we can have forgiveness of sins and everlasting life. We can think about how Jesus sticks closer to us than a brother and never leaves or forsakes us. We can think about how we don't have to carry our burdens all by ourselves because Jesus will carry them for us. We can think about how when we can't find a way, Jesus always does. We can think about how nobody can do us like Jesus. We, in church, we are a representation of God's kingdom. There is no way that anyone who professes to be a part of the kingdom can deny forgiveness to another. Early on in chapter 18, Jesus teaches us to reconcile with one another. He says if a person offends us, we must go to them, tell them what they did. And if they repent and we forgive, healing and reconciliation takes place. There is no way we can let unrepentant sin and unforgiveness exist in God's kingdom of love and peace. When God forgives us, it restores our relationship with God. And when we forgive others, it restores our relationship with them. We ask God daily to forgive our trespasses, and God does. God is always willing to forgive us. If someone sins against us every day, and asks for forgiveness every day, we should be willing to forgive them. Sometimes there are people who have done us wrong who never bother to ask for forgiveness. Maybe they don't know to ask for forgiveness, or maybe they just don't care. But when those things happen, like Jesus, give the situation to God. Giving your situation to God is the only way to stop hurt and anger from infecting our hearts. Forgiveness is what we do because we are forgiven. Forgiveness is not something we do only when we feel like it. It's not something we practice only with our family and our friends. Forgiveness is essential to our Christian walk. It is a part of our Christian character. God showers us with grace, which includes God's love and forgiveness. And we can't help but do the same for others. When we forgive, let go, and let God, we free ourselves for joyful and peaceful living. We are bound together in love. Don't let unforgiveness break the bonds of love in the church. We need each other to survive. Forgiving is sometimes hard, but not forgiving is harder. So don't let another day go by holding on to unforgiveness and the pain that it causes. Forgive. Let go and let God. Forgive from your heart. Let the church say, amen. It is now that time in our service when we invite someone who is looking for a church home to become part of Hartsdale Mount Zion United Methodist Church. So the doors of the church are open virtually. You may come on membership transfer. You can come on the profession of faith. You can come and join the fellowship of loving and forgiving people who will nurture you and to help you grow in things of God. If that describes you today and you're listening, all you have to do is inbox me on Facebook and I will do what I can to help you become a member of this great church. Come today. stubborn if they say, lead me. We pray we don't have to, but don't be a hero hanging at your house in another house. Can't get enough of you. Listen to this good word. Go with the love of God. Go with the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Go empowered by the Holy Spirit, knowing that you can let go and let God and forgive because you are forgiven. Go in peace.